It's a good moment to discuss how close are we to becoming leaders, at least on certain issues? What are the conditions that are conducive to that, allow us to evolve like leaders? And what is there yet to be worked on? And I think there are many developments that actually put the Baltic states in a good place to become real leaders. I've been fascinated, for example, observing consequences of the economic crisis and EU's policy making. It is somehow visible that the countries who have managed to handle the economic crisis reasonably okay have acquired additional self-confidence from that, and their voice counts for more, and they are in a better position to actually make difference on foreign policy as well. And you can see that that camp includes Germany, it includes Poland, it includes most of the Baltic states, maybe Estonia especially, because Estonia went up the hill and joined Euro as the most unpopular moment for Europe, but the others as well have handled it well. It also includes Ireland, who was in deep trouble but has got the trouble under control. But then you see other countries that are in nervous breakdown, and that affects their overall relationship to the EU as well as the world. They are lost, they don't know where to go, they don't know what their strategy is, what is it that they ought to want. And that is pretty sad and pretty destructive. So we have emerged well in that sense. Also, I think our overall experience with the EU, but also before that, is good. I sometimes joke that the thing that makes Estonia to really mobilize itself is to have some sort of elite club of countries that want to join, but that doesn't quite want us. And then we really mobilize ourselves, make it work, and break through. And that was the case with United Nations to start with. I mean, independence was a kind of uphill struggle. And then European Union, and NATO, and Europe. And that actually, I think, has given us some healthy self-confidence, experience that hard work actually pays off. And that means that we believe, based on experience, that our fate is in our hands, at least up to a point. I also think it's healthy that we haven't had too much easy money. We had some during the economic boom, and that did no good things to us. I think risking to become unpopular, I think easy money is a bad thing, regardless of its origins. Regardless of whether it comes from oil and gas, as in Russia, or Russian oligarchs, as in London, or Swedish banks and European subsidies, as in Estonia during the boom, it doesn't do good things. It makes people on the one hand arrogant, on the other hand fearful, because they know that their wealth is not their own doing, and that means it can disappear as easily as it came. Luckily we haven't had that, and that means we have sort of more healthy attitude towards life, we are self-reliant, we are more realistic on many things. And also, of course, foreign policy agenda, currently agenda, Ukraine, Crimea, Russia, all that is something where we might have special insights and things to say, and people are now more willing to listen to us than earlier. And many people see in the media, many say that we thought that the Baltics were alarmist and paranoid, but now we see that you are right about everything. And here I get to the duties. That was a list of positive conditions, but starting with that same agenda, well, this is not actually true that the Baltic states knew all along what was coming. Many people put it that way these days, but this is just not true. Likewise, many people who have advocated restoration of the Soviet Union in Russia for all 20 plus years, that doesn't make them yet architects of Russia's current policy. And likewise, us being suspicious about Russia all along doesn't mean that we have good enough analyses that we have predicted annexation of Crimea. The only thing that the Baltic states really knew, I suppose, not intuitively, but by being exposed to Russian debate fairly closely, was that Russia hasn't made a clean break with its past and past practices the way it should have done. That has been obvious all along. But that is about it. On a more sophisticated level, I don't think we were really any wiser than others. But we can be wiser, because I think, yet again, Baltic states are in a good position to follow Russia and understand Russia. We speak the language, we understand what is meant by it. And that is my complaint about our countries. We declare that certain things are our priorities, say Eastern Partnership countries or Eastern Partnership as policy. We have said that is our priority all along. But what do we do about it? How is it our priority? Do we send our Western private diplomats to Eastern Partnership countries? Do we take our analyses in order to make ourselves the best specialists on the Eastern Partnership in the EU? Do we convert that into policy proposals? I'm not really sure. And what I often compare it to, what was a good lesson to me, there is a wonderful book, sadly available in Swedish and Estonian and maybe some other obscure language, not English, by Lars Fredéed, who was Carl Bildt's right-hand man in the Baltics in the early 90s when Carl was prime minister. And you can see how Sweden worked. They really sent their best intellectual minds to the Baltic states, who really got to know everyone in the Baltic states, who really had a very good overview. And that overview was passed on to the Swedish government, who then became the most knowledgeable country about the Baltic states. And that allowed Sweden to shape European as well as United States policies on the Baltics and Russia, and keep in mind we were not even in the EU at the time, but making it a little bit more to simplify, you can argue that withdrawal of Russian troops from the Baltics took place because Carl Bildt managed to convince Bill Clinton that this was necessary, and Bill Clinton then had certain conversations with Boris Yeltsin, and then Boris Yeltsin had conversations with his colleagues, and that's how it happened. Sweden, of course, did it because of self-interest, not altruism, and was clear enough communicating that to the Baltic states. Many from our then leadership had told me that, you know, Sweden is not our friend. They care most, first of all, about Sweden, about us. And that is probably true. At the same time, from the book you see how they have had discussions, and very serious, thoroughgoing discussions, how they can defend the Baltic states should something go wrong, what are the things they can do for us, what are the things they cannot. So they promised less than they did. And my feeling is that we collectively, Europe collectively, has promised to Eastern Partnership countries more than we ever could do, than we ever meant to do. Ways quite well positioned. We are good facilitators of discussions, for example. And that is actually a legacy of, I would say, a legacy of NATO enlargement and the crowd of East Europeans that was brought together by certain American policymakers, maybe first and foremost the late Erasmus. But some others who plotted NATO enlargement, who met at conferences here and there, and got to know each other, and they still communicate. They still meet at conferences in the Baltics, elsewhere, and this is a powerful intellectual resource that actually policymakers in the world ought to use more. Very few do these days. Obama doesn't at all, and I think that is visible from his policies, really. He would develop to be more part of, to tap into that intellectual wealth. But for us, it's there. We can use it to plot our policy. But we also need to learn better how to present ourselves and how to build coalitions. Because yet again, we are existentially interested in certain idealistic world order being preserved, in the sort of European order where countries can join the alliance if they want, if they qualify. And that is endangered. Russia's actions in Crimea are exactly against that principle. How others get it wrong you need to come out with realistic alternative policies and try to build coalitions among them. You need to pay attention to your tone. It's not useful to just be alarmist. Often you can pass the same message in constructive disguise, and that has a big, much bigger chance of working. So I think I will. I don't have a grand finale, really. I think it's all we need to do is really to get more serious and more focused in our work, and then I think we can be very useful to ourselves as well as to the EU.
This year is an important year in marking the different anniversaries, and say also developments and achievements, what we have achieved in the last 20 or 10 years. Even though I think we really should sort of express a disclaimer, because taking into account that some would say that Estonians are a Nordic nation and Lithuanians are a Central European nation, actually the only Baltic nation is Latvians. but of course this is just a disclaimer saying that we are different, we have our own emphasis, our own interests, but of course once you come back to the major events in the last more than 20 years, certainly it has been done together, be it the Baltic Way, what was mentioned here 25 years ago. In these days, 20 years ago, we finalized also withdrawal of Russian troops from Latvia and Estonia, of course, Lithuania came a little bit earlier. And then 10 years ago, of course, we became members of EU and NATO. And 2014 must have been a year of, you can say, celebration of successes. And also the current successes, because as it was mentioned in the previous panel, Lithuania did a great job, I think, during the EU presidency. Lithuania wanted to be like Poles, have a great presidency, and I think they succeeded in this. Of course, now Latvians want to be like Lithuanians. Also following the example of the Lithuanian EU presidency, advancing Eastern Partnership agenda, advancing transatlantic agenda, and also coming out of the crisis and showing that we are responsible and successful in this regard. But of course, Ukrainian events changed quite a number of things. Yeah, so that we realize that we still live in a geopolitically quite a challenging environment. We live in a neighborhood where still imperial or post-imperial adjustment is taking place, a post-imperial hangover, if you wish, is taking place. And of course, it has been discussed a lot, and we can still go into the Q&A session. But I think there are also some risks which emanate from the crisis, the spillover effect, which also to some extent creates risks also for the Baltic countries. I would not like to over-dramatize the situation. Of course, as it was mentioned also by Lena Zinkevicius, the country which is supposed to be one of the guarantees of stability and status quo, also regional one, is actually becoming the guarantee of instability and disorder in the region as well, actually creating the source of risks and concerns in the region. And the risk as well is that Russia might entrap itself also domestically and internationally its own policies, and once you entrap yourself, even in your own rhetoric, even in your own credibility game, I think it's very difficult to go back from it. And that's why, of course, these risks are still there on the table, and let's take it serious. So that's why 2014 has not been an easy, it has been quite a complicated year. Even so, not the first year, not the last year for Baltic countries as well. So I think we have our own immune system and being really vaccinated to some extent in this regard. But even in this context, that's why one may say that EU and NATO membership is even double important, it's even more important in creating Baltic membership of EU and NATO has taken away questions about the gray zones in the region, who belongs to what. Which actually is one of the issues, one of the challenges with Ukraine, not only with Ukraine. Of course, joining those organizations, even though it's already 10 years, it's never ending story. It has never stopped, and it's actually never stopping. I would even say that Ukrainian crisis, cynically or not, but it has its own silver lining for the Baltic states. Because
years, in 2014, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia has actually finally joined the NATO, what it was joining in 2004. Because in 2004 it was joining the organization which is security community, which is a defense organization, efficient one, where Latvia and again our brother nations are full-fledged members of this. In 2004 we joined basically a political organization, and it was a question, would we somebody able to defend us? Contingency planning just appeared in 2008. Being part of, you can say, industrial economic community, which by some also is perceived with regard to NATO, it was when we had the Northern Distribution Network. And 2014, at least hopefully we may say that we became the community of common perceptions, of common values, in a sense of common perception that actually the Baltic security also matters. And all the reinforcement and reassurance, which was expressed already in strategies of NATO in 2010, I think in a clarity, in a very clear way, has been exactly underlined right now. So it's provided opportunities for the people and provide opportunities for the country as well to position itself in a different way. And one may say the economic crisis, again, it has its sort of silver lining. Regardless, of course, very importantly, economic difficulties, this old division, new and old, West and East, I think it has been a little bit more mixed right now. That you might speak of the South and North, and of course Thomas Henrik Ilves is very frequently repeating the Protestantic North, and which takes care of responsibilities and values and agreements and with a more Southern attitude. So that's my idea. Of course, I think it was also the good moment of show that we are also part of the community of the responsible. Yeah, so that we may be responsible as well, and I think this has been an important opportunity for the country and to some extent for the people, even though, again, let's not deny the difficulties, economic difficulties, and some challenges for many people in our communities, in our countries. What are the challenges that the party mentioned? And I think that being part of the community of the responsible, I think that being part of the EU exactly has taught how to become responsible. And the Eastern Partnership has been one of the instruments of this. That we are not just asking, so how you can subsidize us, how you can support us, how you can contribute to us, but actually exactly the question of this panel, how we can contribute to the security of the European Union and NATO. What is our contribution to this? I think it's very important. And I think the our contribution to the Eastern Partnership Initiative, being more active in the neighborhood, being more active also in Central Asia, being more active in South Caucasus, it's also partly about the trying to take some role and having a positive agenda. And I think it's very, very important, because before EU and also NATO enlargement, this perceptions of insecurity, perceptions of victimization, perceptions of smallness, play a very instrumental and important role, and they're not always positive one. I think now being part of the wider community, we can be much more calm about what's going on, and we can take also the leadership role, and I think actually also contributing to stability and security of the whole European continent, as we would hope so, despite also some challenges and concerns. It was mentioned here, and even though we are far from being extremely successful, and again we can go into this in a Q&A session, and there are a lot of challenges, and we are divided, and some would say the EU energy policies, Kyoto, Lisbon, and Moscow pillars, and Moscow pillar is still very important, the supply pillar from Moscow, from Russia to be more precise, of course, is still playing a very important role. But I cannot resist saying that, look, my name is Andris, the ambassador is Andris, and also the first commissioner of energy was Andris Piebalgs. I think in 2000, when he took a position 10 years ago, well, EU energy policy was basically zero. Latvia could get the commissioner of energy because it was not the most heavy portfolio. In 2009, it became already the German as the energy commissioner, already showing actually development and political importance of that portfolio. So let's not deny that some developments have taken place. Let's deny also that the Baltic countries In terms of electricity, always say, look, this island. Yes, it's island, energy island, but electricity already is a peninsula, energy peninsula of the EU. We are more and more interconnected. Yes, it's a little bit more difficult. Yes, it's a more trickier. Of course, it's not just about the supplies from Russia, it's about interest groups, it's about the difficulty and not always political leadership of liberalizing the markets. It's also about the, you can say, energy welfare in other countries, that we are used to some permanence and some kind of stability in supplies, even though it's not always the most the cheapest ones. The French philosopher said it's an everyday referendum, and if what was good yesterday perhaps not good today, and Ukrainian things show it, what was good yesterday today is a failed state, basically. Of course, that's why the building the nation and also the building or belonging to integrative space of Euro-Atlantic community, it's also every day's referendum. What was good yesterday today might not be good anymore tomorrow. So that's why, of course, it's never-ending story. As I said, we are continuously integrating. That's why, again, this EU presidency next year is important in this regard as well. So my favorite thing is that we should do our homework. It's not always expect what the EU can do for us, but paraphrase, of course, John Kennedy, what we can do for the EU, or with what we can do for NATO, or with what we can do for the Euro-Atlantic community. Estonians always like, when I was surprised that Kadri did mention that contribute is a top percent for defense, and the Latvians and Lithuanians are a little bit more lagging behind in this regard. Of course, also the, ensuring the common security also depends on taking care of our defense and also actually showing that we are responsible partners in solidarity. And regional things, of course, are important. We have not ratified the border agreement still with Lithuanians, and there are some debates and discussions and disagreements about energy and also transportation. We move forward, but it's not an easy one. But at the very end, also, it's important.
We'll start from my main and the only one argument, which is linked to the question that was posed to us by the organizers, what Baltic states can contribute to European security. My argument is that they contribute by contributing to the implementation of objectives of all the organizations to which they belong. For example, Estonia is by now quite well known for its sound public finances. As you probably know, Estonia has the lowest debt, state debt in the EU, 28, one of the lowest budget deficits. And I think it is a good example of how it is contributing to the health of Eurozone and the objectives of the economic and monetary union. When Lithuania started, not much was expected from its presidency. It was relatively unknown country to most in the European Union. We had some studies done several years ago about coalition building in the EU, and it showed very clearly that Lithuania usually builds coalitions with its neighbors, which is quite understandable because neighbors usually have common concerns. So it's usually Latvia, Estonia, Poland, sometimes Germany, sometimes Nordic countries with which Lithuania coordinates its position in the EU Council. But to the rest of the EU, Lithuania was relatively unknown. Plus, it belongs to a group of what are called small countries, and the budget which was allocated for the presidency understandably was rather modest, 62 million euros for 3 years. Taking into account economic situation, just recent recovery from the crisis, although fast recovery, but still very recent. These were the main constraints, I would say, which characterized the start of the presidency. Plus, we have to take into account the political calendar. First of all, European Parliament elections this year. You know, they will be held this May, the same day as elections in Ukraine, which by the way, I think are more important to European future than elections of the European Parliament. That's just in the brackets. When the political cycle ends and elections approach, understandably, MEPs become more active than usual. So again, this was very visible during the Lithuanian presidency, this also changed quite significantly the nature of the presidency and interaction between the Council and the European Parliament, which also has to be seen in the context of the Lisbon Treaty. It's very obvious that the European Parliament is flexing its institutional muscles. I think sometimes the show of their institutional importance borders on the policy irrelevance, because they, in some cases, simply want to make the point that the European Parliament is important and has to be listened to. And that happened quite a lot during the presidency. Plus, there were elections in Germany, as you know, last September, which also had an effect on certain policy issues on files like Eastern Partnership, also Banking Union, Single Resolution Mechanism, which was proposed just at the start of the presidency by the European Commission. To conclude, what were the factors of effective presidency? And I think this lesson drawing exercise could be interesting also for our colleagues in Latvia and Estonia, who will be in the presidency chair quite soon. I think there are several factors which I would personally underline. One was early preparations, logistics, trainings of people, schedules of rotation to permanent representation in Brussels. All these preparations were started actually rather early. Debates about presidency started after Lithuania joined the EU. I remember already in 2005 there were some papers prepared by our Minister of Foreign Affairs. Real intensive preparations started around 2010. This, I think, is one important factor. Another factor is political continuity. We usually have failures of long-term projects which extend beyond one cycle of our parliamentary term when parties do not seriously agree on certain priorities. Here, I think there was quite strong agreement. And we had elections in 2012, autumn 2012. So the new coalition, which was formed, new government, it started its work just half a year before the presidency, which of course did not help. But due to this political consensus, political agreement among the main parliamentary parties regarding the priorities of the presidency and the need to continue, especially with personal appointments, which is, I think, the most important issue, so that key people are not replaced when ministers change. I think this was another important factor which contributed to this good preparation for the presidency. Also, understanding of the nature of the presidency. The fact that it's not about your national priorities. I think initially, especially some members of our parliament thought that presidency is an opportunity to advance your national priorities. Some people I know from the interviews, some members of our parliament thought now it will be a good chance for Lithuania to Rail Baltica or things like that. And this is not what the presidency is about. Presidency is about advancing EU legislative agenda, about common EU interests. And I think that was very important to understand for people who were directly involved into the presidency. And this understanding became quite strong around early 2013. I think preparations, drafting of the presidency program, or also coordination between the trio, Lithuanian, Greek, Irish trio, all this showed to policymakers that it's about EU legislative agenda, it's not about national priorities. And this was also, by the way, reflected in how our presidency priorities were formulated, because initially we had four priorities, which were Eastern Partnership, energy security, Baltic Sea strategy, and border management. Advancing these issues, these were the initial Lithuanian presidency priorities. In early 2013, they became open, credible, growing Europe. So I think this is also a reflection of this change in perception what the presidency is about. And finally, one more important administrative factor which contributed to fast reactions and decision-making during the presidency, because it was faced from the beginning with crisis. You know, Syrian crisis, there was in July, just as when Lithuania took its presidency, I think the next day or 2 days after the start of the presidency, there was this scandal about American National Security Agency listening to phone calls of EU member states leaders. So there had to be fast reactions. And what helped was the fact that it was Brussels-based presidency. The model which was chosen gave most responsibilities to our permanent representation in Brussels. They did not have to go to our parliament for the approval of any, to get mandate. There was advanced mandate for the whole 6 month term of the presidency. So most of the action took place in Brussels in our permanent representation, and I think it also enabled Lithuanian presidency to function more effectively. So I hope these lessons will be useful also to our friends in Latvia and Estonia. I think that this record of the Lithuanian presidency made, at least I see that it made some politicians in Lithuania more self-confident. I think it made our diplomats more self-confident, and I think it's a good thing. It made understanding of EU general common objectives stronger, and that's how I think such countries like the Baltic States can contribute to